Welcome to Blues Weekly, brought to you by Scott Credit Union. I'm Brooke Grimsley. The Blues have new life after tying the series up today in Game 4. Like a magician, head coach Craig Berube pulling out his bag of tricks, changing the lines, and making a goalie change, giving Jordan Binnington the starting nod. Let's see how Berube and the Blues pulled off their greatest magic trick of the playoffs, stunning the Wild despite being shorthanded. The Blues defense still depleted. No Nick Leddy or Robert Bortuzzo and Marco Scandella leaving this game early, but Scott Perunovic stepping in, coming off the injured list, his first time playing since January. In the first period, the Blues strike first. Jordan Kyrou comes flying in, fires one at Marc-Andre Fleury, grabs his own rebound and scores. Kyrou with the first goal of the game. But still in the first, the Wild respond. Spurgeon here finds Kirill Kaprizov open in front and he scores. Can't give Kirill the thrill opportunities like that. Second period still tied 1-1, but here come the Blues. David Perron with the shot, but the Wild struggle to clear it out of the crease. A wacky goal for the Blues, but hey, we'll take it. Perron makes it a 2-1 lead. The Blues keep pushing. Ryan O'Reilly picks off the back pass, feeds to Kyrou, who goes between the legs to backhand for a beautiful goal. That makes it 3-1 Blues. And in the third period, the Wild make it a one-goal game, but the Blues fire back. Perron rips one from long distance and scores on the empty netter. His second goal of the day right there. Then the Blues captain Ryan O'Reilly really puts this game to bed, snaps home the one-timer for the power play goal. 5-2, the final score. The Blues win Game 4, tying the series. Jordan Binnington with 28 saves, his first playoff win since Game 7 in Boston back in 2019.
And anytime, you know, obviously you can get the first goal, and, you know, it's a huge, huge confidence booster for the team. And, you know, especially here at home, you know, the crowd was unbelievable tonight. So, yeah, definitely got us going.
These are why we play. These are fun moments. And, you know, there's adversity and it's just backing it up and picking yourself up and trying to get back at it again. And, you know, it was an opportunity for me tonight. And, you know, we played a heck of a game and we kept it tight. And, I think now, you know, we just shift our focus to next game and prepare.
Taking a look at what's next, with the series tied, the Blues with a big chance heading into Game 5 in Minnesota on Tuesday. Then they'll be back at home on Thursday for Game 6. Still waiting on a game time for that one, and a possible Game 7 will be back in Minnesota. Let's go to Enterprise Center, where I caught up with the voice of the Blues, Chris Kerber, right after the game today. We're here over at Enterprise Center, and what a win it was for fans today. Chris Kerber, the Blues giving a lot of the moms out there something to celebrate on Mother's Day, a 5-2 victory. Now the series is tied up. What were your thoughts on today's game? It was absolutely electric in here in Enterprise Center.
Yeah, it was a happy Mother's Day, I think, for all the moms in attendance. And the cool part was we had some of the moms of some of the players here as well. There was a great standing ovation for Mrs. O'Reilly during the game, Brooke. That part was neat. I also think that The way this game went and the way the Blues wanted to come in, calm, cool, collected, but intense. They learned the lesson from Game 3. The crowd was electric. It was loud. It was fun. And to get that early lead, to get that first goal, then to make it 2-0 was such a big thing, allowed them to play the game that they needed to play today.
Well, and as we know, head coach Craig Berube, always with his bag of tricks, really changing things up today, especially with Jordan Binnington. What were your thoughts on giving Jordan Binnington the starting nod today and also his performance? 28 saves today, fantastic for him.
You know, I have felt for a long time that this playoff series, and around the league you're seeing this actually, in a lot of ways is going to take two goaltenders. The schedule is such, the way the Blues played is another reason for that. And Jordan Binnington was feeling that groove going down the stretch a little bit. It made perfectly good sense to start with Ville Husso. But Craig Berube told us before the game he needed a change. He wanted just a change of feel. And Jordan Binnington came in and delivered exactly what he needed to deliver. Great saves. And an absolutely mammoth save with a two-goal lead when Minnesota's on the power play to get across the crease and make a save on Kirill Kaprizov. That was one of those playoff kind of saves, the kind of save like he made in Game 7 off of Nordstrom with a 2-0 lead in Game 7 in Boston. That type of save that he made on Kaprizov had that kind of motivating factor, I think, to the team. So he delivered exactly what he needed to do, and I'm thrilled for him. A great moment for him, and it was really neat to see him talk to the crowd tonight.
And what did you think, too, of Craig Berube changing up the lines going into this game? I think it felt like he threw everything but the kitchen sink at them to really just throw Minnesota off. What did you think about that? And they finally generated some goal scoring.
Yeah, and it worked out. It worked out really well. I think a couple of things you saw. Over the last couple of games when he's made some changes as the game's gone on, you saw a little spark between Kyrou and Thomas. That makes you think, okay, that could be a pretty good pairing. Now, I think putting the Russians back together, Ivan Barbashev with Tarasenko and Buchnevich, they've had some really good success. And then you notice a lot of times, too, they ended up with the matchup against that Kaprizov line. So I think there was probably some real pride in there as well in terms of defending against Kirill Kaprizov. So I like that aspect of it. Getting Braden Schenn and his grit up on that top line with Ryan O'Reilly and David Perron. We saw how that reaped benefits today as well. And the big thing was really the decision, because they were unsure defensively how things were going to go, was to go with seven defensemen. Now, this season in the regular season, the St. Louis Blues were 8-4-2 when they used that seven defenseman setup. So they're now 9-4-2 when going with 11 forwards and seven today. So the forwards coming back, helping the defense in that situation, the defensemen doing what they needed to do. And you had Colton Parayko get just over 30 minutes. You had Justin Falk just get over 31 minutes. And you got to go back to the early 2000s, the last time you had two defensemen play 30 minutes in a game that ended in regulation, and that was when you had, you know, Chris Pronger and Al MacInnis going. So a really, really good all-around game and some smart coaching by the Blues to make the line changes they made and then to go with the roster format of seven defensemen.
Well, and it really, you touched on it there. The story of the series has been the fact that the Blues have been beaten up in this, losing a lot of their D-men. You don't like to see that happen. Head coach Craig Berube even saying in his post-game comments that he hasn't experienced something like this before. Nick Leddy and Robert Bortuzzo possibly could come back moving forward. What do you think that the approach will be moving on, especially when we saw that Scandella left with a lower body injury?
Well, I think you like the way that the Blues had with the seven defensemen. Now, are they going to be able to do that in the next game? You may not be able to, because the only way the Blues can go with seven defensemen is if they have a defenseman hurt that doesn't allow them to dress six. It's that whole emergency recall thing. And because the Blues farm team in Springfield is in the playoffs and is still playing, the Blues don't have any more call-ups available unless it is an emergency situation like we saw tonight. So that said, if you do get a couple of those guys back, you're going to be pretty happy that you get Nick Leddy back and Robert Bortuzzo if you get those guys back. What's crazy about this series is the Blues have had a defenseman get hurt in every single game. And in the last three games, they've had to finish the game without a defenseman in there. And ironically, in all three of those games, a defenseman has been hurt by the end of the first period, so they've had to play most of the games down a defenseman. And it was in the first period that Leddy took the hit in game number one, but he still finished that game before eventually missing the last three. So, yeah, it has been a real unique one. You know, in 2019, the Blues were really healthy going through the playoffs. They're able to avoid kind of the catastrophic injuries. That hasn't happened here. You know, of course, Torrey Krug is out for quite some time, to take Craig Berube's quote. So it's just one of those battle situations. They were able to do the seven defensemen and get a little insurance in this one. I don't even know if that's roster-wise going to be available to them because of the call-up rules that they have to deal with their American League team still playing. So we'll have to find out. But I think now that the coaching staff has seen what the Minnesota coaches, Dean Evason, wants to do in Minnesota, who they're trying to get the key matchups against. Now you've had the Blues have two games on home ice. It'll become quite a chess match in game number five up there in Minnesota.
And what do you think, too, of Scott Perunovich's performance today? Hobie Baker Award winner, and he performed great. And I know it was just a limited capacity, but still, even head coach Craig Berube was impressed with him today and also stepping up on the power play as well.
Listen, that took some real composure because, here's a guy that probably could have made the team out of camp. But the numbers for the Blues defense were all healthy, so they sent best collegiate player in collegiate hockey. And then he's also a national champion. He's played in some pressure situations. I think, Brooke, to come into this game the way he did and handle the minutes the way he did, manage the power play, that top power play unit, for the better part of the four-minute power play that they had because of the high sticking penalty, he looked really, really good. And I think that's got to be very encouraging, not just for the St. Louis Blues organization, but Blues fans as well.
Well, and also speaking of the power play, Ryan O'Reilly with a power play goal today. He was just fantastic out there. And as you mentioned, very composed as well. What'd you think of his performance? They were testing him quite a bit out there today.
Yeah, Joe Vitale and I on our postgame show, we called this the captain's game. You know, Craig Berube had a team meeting. He described it as a tough meeting. I'm sure some things that were said that probably hit some guys right between the eyes. He didn't like some of the demeanor on the bench. He didn't like some of what he saw and how the Blues were reacting to things that were happening in game number three. They came out really composed in game number four here. And the reason is the leadership of Ryan O'Reilly. This guy gets to the rink early. He gets to the rink 3 hours early. He puts in the work. He manages time. He can extend his shift because he's in shape. The reason the St. Louis Blues were able to get one of the goals from Jordan Kyrou in that second period, it happened. And if you go back and look at it, it happened on a line change. But Ryan O'Reilly extended his shift, kept the puck alive in the offensive zone while his teammates changed behind him. They get the puck to Jordan Kyrou. And bang, it's in the net on a great backhanded goal, and you've extended the lead. So, you know, those are things the captain does. That line, that gritty line of Stanley Cup champions of Shen, O'Reilly, and Perron really came through and led the way for the St. Louis Blues. And along with Ryan O'Reilly, David Perron had such a terrific game again. And I believe at this point in time, he's leading this series in points with 7 now. So he's been really, really good. And they needed that line to lead the way. It did.
And last question for you. Of course, it was huge winning here in game four, but we got to go back to Minnesota. What are your thoughts on what they're going to need to do to win in Minnesota?
Exact same thing that they did tonight. Keep it simple. Even if you do get a couple of defensemen back, you've got to keep it simple. You've just got to make the smart plays. On the road, you got to stay high percentage hockey in the playoffs. If there's a play and you think you're going to try to bounce it off the wall to somebody and the other team's going to keep it in the zone, it's going to be hard to win. They've got to get the puck out of the zone when the exit is there. They've got to get clean. They've got to do something in this series that they did pretty well tonight. They did okay with it in game number one. They've got to win the rush battle. They've got to get more plays off the rush than they give up, and that's going to be a key up there. So Minnesota's going to get the last change. Dean Evason is going to get some of his, you know, matchups that they want. The special teams continue to be big. The penalty kill got the job done, going 4-for-4. The power play is scored in every single game. Put all that together, and the Blues are still just going to have to play a simple, smart, patient, safe, disciplined game. And if you do that, you've got a good chance of coming back home with a 3-2 lead. That crazy, pivotal game five. And this best of seven's now become a best of three, and it's awesome.
Great hearing from Curbs. Well, coming up after the break, we take you behind the scenes to the Blues locker room right after that Game 4 win today. That's ahead on Blues Weekly.